Over the past 33 years, Robert Hagopian has become an institution at Scotts Valley Middle School. Admired by his fellow teachers, revered by his students, he has maintained his boyish enthusiasm, becoming an inspiration to all those who know and love him. This is his story. Bob's grandparents emigrated from Armenia to the United States in the last years of the 19th century. Settling in the large Armenian community outside of Fresno, they adjusted to the rural economy, bought land, and became farmers. Here, in the small town of Dinuba, Bob's father, Lemuel, or Lemus he was called, grew up. Using money sent to him from his older sister, he moved to study at UC Berkeley. With a degree in civil engineering, Lem began work for the California Bridge Department. He soon became involved in a huge construction project, a new bridge spanning the San Francisco Bay. During his visits back home to Dinuba, he became better acquainted with an attractive 18-year-old, Flora Chavichian. They were married at the Hagopian family ranch in the summer of 1933. After the ceremony, they moved to Oakland for Lem to continue his work on the Bay Bridge until its completion. Tiring of the bureaucracy, Lem quit his job. He experimented with several business ventures, from making honey to owning a paint store and a gas station. Lem eventually found success in the manufacture and rental of trailers, as well as investing in the stock market and real estate. Living in Sacramento, and after 3 years of marriage, Flora and Lem started a family. Two boys were born, Leon in 1937 and Charles, born in 1940. After working as a typist during World War II, Flora gave birth to her third son at Sutter Hospital in July 1946, Robert Allen Hagopian. The two older boys had a great affection for their baby brother, and Flora was delighted. She called Bob her little joy boy. Bob's childhood was happy and carefree. With a kind and generous temperament, he made friends easily. With a cap pistol in hand, he loved to portray himself as a hero of the Old West. When Bob was 7 years old, the family moved from downtown Sacramento with its noisy trucks and freight trains passing close by to the newly developed neighborhood of Arden Park. A little later, Bob developed a great interest in baseball. Avidly, he collected and traded cards and would spend hours tabulating and recording statistics. He acted out his love of the game on a little league team where his enthusiasm was clearly visible. Around the age of 10, Bob was shown a book on the American presidents. It fascinated him. He would spend long hours memorizing facts. This was the first sign of a love and obsession that would fill the rest of his life. For young Robert, listening to his father recite historical facts at the dinner table was captivating. It encouraged his emerging interest in American history. In high school, Bob stopped playing baseball and took up golf instead. As with baseball, he showed great enthusiasm for the sport, and it has been a source of pleasure throughout his life. But academically, Bob was faring poorly in school and putting in little effort. Concerned, Flora and Lem spoke to Chuck, who was now studying mathematics at Sacramento State University. Chuck began a mentoring program, forcing his brother to work much harder. Bob was shown new techniques and better work habits. A transformation began. He began approaching his schoolwork with a newfound vigor. Soon he was staying up late, studying for tests and scoring straight A's. Bob graduated from high school in June of 1964. Attracted to the city, he enrolled at San Francisco State and chose to major in history. Bob had a close circle of friends. This group of young men formed a strong bond that continues to hold tight to this day. Living in the college dormitories, Bob's handsome dark features and boyish grin attracted attention on campus. One morning at breakfast, Bob spotted a couple of freshman girls in the dining hall. He knew one of them, but the other he'd only briefly met the day before. He had asked her, "Are you someone's little sister?" Her name was Annette Nelson, and she had been amused and somewhat offended by the question. Patiently waiting for the first girl to walk away and get some coffee, he approached and asked Annette if she was interested in studying with him. That afternoon, they drove south to Montara Beach. They read, talked, and walked along the beach together. From that day on, Bob and Annette were inseparable. Annette loved Bob's lighthearted attitude. He made her laugh. She adored how he had his own unique style, even down to his red tennis shoes. Bob enjoyed Annette's bright, sunny conversation and thought her to be an incredibly fun companion. With both of them working part-time jobs, the next year was taken up with school, friends, and getting to know each other. On a spring morning, full with the scent of peach blossoms, Annette and Bob traveled to the Lutheran Church in Oroville. With their families and a few friends in attendance, Annette and Bob were married. They were both excited and a little nervous for the future. What were the rest of their lives to be like? They were both 19 years old. The following morning, they drove back to San Francisco to be ready for Monday classes. In the summer of 1966, Bob and Annette moved to Sacramento. Studying history and government journalism at Sacramento State, Bob took out student loans and earned additional money as a copy boy at the Sacramento Union newspaper. Although lacking money, their worries seemed to evaporate with the arrival of their daughter, Alyssa. She was a joy. With their friends still in college, Bob and Annette would take their daughter everywhere with them. In 1969, Bob graduated. What next? Part of his work with the Sacramento Union involved attending Governor Reagan's news conferences. The dynamic life of a journalist was a lure for Bob, but he also loved the story. Soaking up the details, studying biographies, making connections between people and events. Sorting through his options, he decided on a PhD in history. To become a college professor. Initially preferring to study at UCLA, Bob and Annette stopped by the history department at UC Santa Barbara and found it much more to their liking. Moving into a duplex near the beach, the family felt immediately comfortable in the relaxed coastal town. Pleased with the progress he had made in his first year, it was with surprise and dismay that he received a memo from the history department. Its message to him was simple. Give up. The memo stated that the number of history PhD graduates far outweighed the available professor positions. Bob realized that his goal of being a history professor was probably a lost cause. Other events were influencing Bob's thinking at this time. Anti-war protests and marches were sweeping the land. In Santa Barbara, students rioted and burnt down a Bank of America branch. Curfews and martial law were declared. Appalled, Annette and Bob protested with other students, but the police responded with billy clubs and tear gas. Fearful, they ran home with Alyssa before they could be arrested. Annette and Bob responded to these events with a burst of idealism. They realized that teaching was still a powerful way to affect change. What if they could improve the world one student at a time? Maybe they could start their own school, but with their limited resources, that would be hard. How could they support their growing family if Bob was to spend another couple of years in a teacher credential program? One answer would be to teach in a private school where no credential was required. So after gaining his master's in the summer of 1971, Bob became a sixth-grade teacher at the exclusive Palm Valley School in Palm Springs. With his affluent students and high-priced tuition, this was an odd setting for Bob to practice his budding idealism. For a new teacher, having eager students and small classes was an enormous advantage. They enjoyed the company of other teachers, but Palm Springs just didn't feel like home. Bob locked away his golf clubs, knowing he could never afford to play. In 1972, they were delighted when another daughter, Chandra, was born. Annette sought out other young mothers with whom to socialize, but could find none. The desert landscape and lack of culture felt oppressive, and they missed their friends and family. They looked for a teaching position at a private school in Northern California. After a series of interviews over the Easter break, Bob was saddened to find that none had offered him a job. Stopping in Santa Cruz to visit old friends, a new idea was proposed. Why not apply to the private schools in the Santa Cruz area while researching what it would take to teach in the public schools? This suggestion sounded far more enticing than soldiering on in Palm Springs. The virtues of a life in Santa Cruz were easy to see. They left and drove through the night, heading south towards desert. With their children sleeping in the back, Bob and Annette talked it through. They became excited. They agreed, "Let's go for it." Bob's parents did not share their excitement, though. Flora wanted them to stay in Palm Springs. But Bob was focused and he researched his options. He discovered that with his master's degree and teaching experience, only a few classes were needed to attain a teaching credential. Sacramento State put obstacles in his way. But Bob would have none of it, and at the end of the summer was ready to teach in the Santa Cruz public schools. All he needed now was a job. Bob applied to all the local school districts. Before the move to Santa Cruz, he had interviewed at Scotts Valley Junior High School. But Principal Riley McKinney had a clear idea of the type of teacher he wanted to hire. Someone with good musical skills and lots of backpacking experience. Bob just didn't quite fit those requirements. So Bob started the school year as a substitute teacher. Ted Burke offered him a part-time job at the Shadow Brook restaurant. For the next 10 years, he would work the Saturday night shift. Bob was enormously content with his home life. The time he spent with his wife and two growing daughters was always the most precious. They were his source of pride. Alyssa and Chandra saw their father as a warm and stable presence, a wise and loving guide to their ever-growing world. Full-time teaching just wasn't agreeing with the man that Scotts Valley had hired instead of Bob. So in October 1973, Bob joined Scotts Valley's staff, teaching journalism and helping out with the backpacking class. Those early years of teaching were a challenge for Bob, interacting and dealing with students, planning lessons, and finding the time to teach all the requirements. But with experience, Bob refined his classroom techniques and got better results. He was more satisfied with his performance. Bob came to realize that he had a special calling to teach middle school. He saw that the children in his classes were able to think and question for themselves, yet they still believed that the world could be a wonderful place. Eventually, Bob specialized in teaching his favorite subject, American history. Bringing passion into the classroom, his favorite lessons came to feature the Constitution, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, and the Civil War. His students marveled at his storytelling ability, the way he could make small details seem magical and bring the past to life. One student was to later write, "I have learned and achieved many things in your class, and with such insight, I doubt that I shall ever again have such a teacher." Another student later marveled, "He has an encyclopedic memory of every person he's ever met and everything he's ever read." He became the school's source of knowledge when any questions arose. Bob became an active union negotiator and would often speak on behalf of teachers at school board meetings. But later, when opportunities came for Bob to enter into administration or teach high school, he rejected them. He knew where he belonged. Annette became busier after returning to school at San Jose State. Bob helped out at home by preparing dinners. He took on this new role with relish and perfected his own cooking techniques. One afternoon, Bob and Annette spotted an attractive Victorian house opposite their children's school. It was for sale, and not being too large, they thought it might fit their budget. They were able to stretch their finances and move into the house on 1408 Broadway in the summer of 1978. The house needed work. Over the coming years, they would tear out walls, add a bathroom, rewire, remodel the kitchen, and refinish the floors. For Alyssa and Chandra, summer meant the echo of hammers as the latest renovation proceeded. As the children grew older and the house progressed, it would include the sound of baseball on the radio as their father worked in his beloved garden. By the time the girls reached high school, it was with pride that they realized the recognition their last name, Hagopian, evoked. Everyone seemed to know and love their father. After Alyssa's high school graduation, Bob decided to take his family on a historical exploration of the East Coast. It was their first time outside of California together, and both girls resented being away from Santa Cruz. But with a youthful passion, Bob swept his family along from one landmark to another, sharing his enthusiasm and knowledge. He opened their eyes to the wider world. Bob returned to the East Coast several more times for history seminars and school trips with students. Bob's daughters would both leave for college. Guided by their parents' encouragements and visits, they both became accomplished and successful women. In 1992, Alyssa left to live in Spain for 3 years, and it afforded Bob and Annette their first opportunity to leave the United States and travel in Europe. Upon her return to the United States, Alyssa married her college sweetheart, Bob Hambrecht. Today they have 3 children, Lem, Anna Rose, and Nate. Chandra went on to work in New York and Los Angeles, finally settling in San Francisco close to her sister. In June of 2005, Chandra married Rafi Kaufman. Bob stayed close to his parents, Lem and Flora, visiting them often during their retirement years in Sacramento. With sadness, he mourned the passing of his father in 1987 and his mother in 1995. Robert Hagopian is approaching 60 years of age, but with youthful energy, he visits the gym at 5:30 each morning, exercising in the spin class. Having taught approximately 5,000 students, Bob has managed to stay vital within his field, graduating a parade of thirsty minds, sharpened and inspired by his training. After many years of wishing those children goodbye and good luck, he now offers his final farewells, for Bob Hagopian is to retire. Looking forward to a future beyond teaching middle school history, he is eager to be a guiding influence in the lives of his grandchildren, to travel the country and see many good sports, to grow his garden and become a master of the kitchen, to read, learn, and become wiser, and above all, to spend more time with his love of 40 years.